Christ. Lord, that we are here gathered together in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, to worship you, to glorify and honor you, to bless your name, God. We enter your gates with thanksgiving. Lord, this is a day that you have made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. We magnify your holy name. God, we offer up praises to you, God. And Lord, as we move forward in this service, let them be the high praises, God, of your people. Lord, to create an atmosphere and a throne of worship, that your presence would fill this house and manifest upon your people, God, as we glorify and praise you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Well, give him a clap offering of praise. He's worthy. Praise the Lord. God, we just magnify your name. Amen. Praise you, Jesus. Lord, we worship you. Don't we serve a great God? He is awesome. Amen. Lord, we just worship you.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself.
I tell you, praise reports. Thank you, Lord. Well, hey, the scripture this morning Proverbs 17:22. What is it? A merry heart does good like a medicine, but a broken spirit dries the bones. Let's get our merry heart on. We've got the joy of the Lord in us, amen? God's given us something to be merry about. Salvation, being a part of the family of God, we can be merry about that. Carry that around with you. Get yourself well and healthy with a merry heart. Glory to God. Thank you, Lord. Ew, isn't he good? All right, join with me this morning. Stretch your hands towards these requests and let's intercede for these folks. And anyone else who remember that you maybe didn't write a card about, let's pray right now for all the needs. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you so much for being so good. We come before you knowing that you're our God of mercy, of love, of peace, Lord, that we can come before you boldly in the name of Jesus before your throne to obtain mercy in the time of need. Right now for these requests, Lord, we're just asking for healing, for guidance, direction, for provision, for hope, Lord, for lost loved ones, Lord, just bring them home. We're just praying, Father, believing that you already know what's being asked and that you've already sent the answer, and we're believing you for that manifestation of the answer, Father. Thank you so much. Hallelujah. In your precious, precious name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
You know, we live in a crowded world with a lot of demands on our time. Maybe this song is Make Room. And I want you to, just if you can right now, just lift your hands and say, Lord, I want to make room for you. I don't want anything else in the way. I want to make room for you this morning.
do whatever you want to. To do whatever you want to.
Precious name of Jesus Christ. Lord, we make room for you. We honor and glorify and praise your name. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Well, would you give the Lord a clap offering of praise? He is worthy. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. You may be seated for a moment. If you're not already seated, it's good to see you in the house of the Lord. Turn to somebody and say, it's good to see you here. We're glad you came to worship with us. I just want to welcome you to Walnut Creek Church. We are glad you chose to worship with us. And we're thankful for this place here that God has given us to worship together. And over the years, we are excited about what God is doing. How many of you know what our vision for this year is? Go ahead and raise your hand if you remember it. Some of you do. Good. You passed right by it when you walked in. Empowered by the Spirit. Big banner out in the foyer. Empowered by the Spirit. They're going to put that up in just a minute. You're going to see that. We're going to be talking about being empowered by the Spirit this month. We're going to be talking about the fruit. Now turn to somebody and say, know your fruit.
Know your fruit.
Know your fruit. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Want to give you an opportunity to worship in giving right now. Our ushers are going to prepare to give you that opportunity. We have a couple of different ways that you can worship in giving. You can give here in the offering if you have check or cash. If you just have a card, we have a kiosk out in the foyer where you can slide your card. If you do it online, we have two ways to do it. You can go to wccmansfield.org, click on the Take Action button at the bottom of the page, and that lets us, or you are able to give that way. Just notate where you want it to go, and you can go. We have Zelle giving. Anybody know what Zelle is? If your bank supports Zelle, you go to wcctreasurer200@yahoo.com. Be sure to put your last name and where you want it to go, whether it's tithe or offering or youth or children, whatever you're supporting, and that goes directly into our bank account. And Sister Robin, our treasurer, gets that, so she knows where it's supposed to go, and she can notate that. I hope all of you got your giving statements. I think we mailed those out. Is that correct?
Yes.
We mailed those out already. So thank you for your faithful giving. I'm going to ask the ushers to give you an opportunity to worship right now in giving. A little different service. We don't have music during the offering. I guess I should have asked Sister Verna to play an offertory. I didn't think about that. Sister Gina is in Paris with her mother. We spent Friday and Saturday moving her from her old house that she sold into a new house, and Gina's there helping her unpack and get things done. So just be praying for her that she doesn't strain herself, because a lot of times my wife doesn't know when to stop. She just goes and goes. She's like the Energizer Bunny, and then she hurts herself. I'm going to ask the ushers to come. If you would stretch your hands this way, we're going to speak a word over the offering. Father, we thank you and we praise you. God, your word says, bring all the tithe into the storehouse, Lord, we just, as we bring the offering and the tithe into this place today, Lord, whether here online, here in-house or online, God, we give it according to your word, out of obedience to your word, but we also give with a cheerful heart, Lord, because you love a cheerful giver. And Father, we just pray that you would multiply this offering that is given today, both in-house and online, Lord, for your use to further your kingdom and your gospel. And we pray, God, that you would pour out a blessing, open up the windows of heaven, and pour out a blessing that cannot be contained to those who worship you in giving, in Jesus' name. And the church said,
amen.
Amen and amen. Praise the Lord. I'm going to ask you, I know you've been standing and you've just been seated, but I'm going to ask you to stand, and we're going to do our yearly declaration. If you would stand, this comes from John 16, Acts 1 and 2, and Galatians 5, 22 through 25. Turn to somebody and say, we're empowered. You're empowered by the Spirit. You are empowered by the Holy Spirit. I declare that through the power of the Holy Spirit in me, I am empowered to live like Jesus, to walk according to His Word, and to be a witness of Jesus Christ to all the world. Amen. Give Him praise right now. Lord, we thank You and we praise You in the mighty, precious name of Jesus Christ. You can be seated. Sister Heather is going to come at this time and worship in song.
Amen. How many of you this morning are excited in the Lord? Amen. There's just a feeling here this morning in the atmosphere. I don't know if y'all are feeling it, but I'm feeling it this morning. And God is with us here this morning. I'm going to sing a song that was written by one of my good friends, and I'm having Mom to video. Some of y'all will know him as Dr. Tim Hill, but he's recently became known as my singing buddy, and he's wrote this song, so I want to send this out to Dr. Tim Hill this morning, my singing buddy. He's still in the fire. Amen. How many of you glad he was walking in the fire with you when you're in that fire? Amen.
Story from the Bible long ago about Shadrach, Meshach, and old Abednego. How the wicked king commanded they be thrown into the flame because they would not bow and deny their father's name. Mama said the king sat high upon a balcony so tall, and when he looked in, he was shocked by all the things he saw. 'Cause he thought he would find them lying dead upon the ground, but instead of three, he counted four, walking all around. Then I said, Mama, wait a minute, there's one thing that I must know. If three went in, if three came out, then where'd the fourth man go? I never will forget it. Mama danced across the floor, and these are the words I heard her say while shouting through the door. She said, he's still in the fire, and he's walking in the flames, and he'll be there to help you when you call upon his name. And he can still deliver by his almighty power. Right here below, it's good to know he's still in the fire. Well, he's still in the fire, and he's walking in the flames, and he'll be there to help you when you call upon his name. And he can still deliver by his almighty power. Right here below, it's good to know he's still in the fire. Right here below, it's good to know he's still in the fire. Now, my friend, you may be destined to face life's hottest flames, but I am here to tell you through the power of his name. Not one flame will ever touch you. You'll come through, then you'll tell. Yesterday, today, forever, God is still alive and well. He's still in the fire, and he's walking in the flames, and he'll be there to help you when you call upon his name. And he can still deliver by his almighty power. Right here below, it's good to know he's still in the fire. Right here below, it's good to know he's still in the fire.
Praise the Lord. Aren't you glad he's still in the fire? Amen. Amen. Praise God. If I can get you to turn on a couple of the lights that we usually do when we're preaching, because I'm going to be coming down and I don't want to trip on darkness. Amen. If you have your Bibles, you'll turn with me to Galatians chapter 5, verses 16 through 26, and or your app, however you do it. I want to encourage you to keep that out because we're going to be going from Genesis to, well, we're going to be going through a lot of places. Okay. So the title of the message this morning is, what about your fruit? Turn to your neighbor and ask him, what about your fruit? What about your fruit? Maybe you should be saying, what about my fruit? Instead of, what about your fruit? What about your fruit? That's the title of the message. What about your fruit? Because, you know, we're called to bear fruit. Amen. Have you ever, I don't know how you do it at your house, but, you know, if we go to the grocery store and we buy a bill of groceries, we buy some groceries, and we'll start in the produce section. That's because we always go in, and that's the first place we go. Produce, then you go down to the bread aisle, and then the milk and dairy is at the back, and you make the aisles, just kind of weave through. That's always just how we've always done it. And one of my favorite, you know, Gina's parents owned a grocery store and meat market for 40 years in Paris, and I worked for them off and on for a little while. And one of my favorite things is seeing a really nice produce section. Man, when it's all spritzed up and it looks good and it's fresh. But you know, fruit can be deceiving. Because you can see a piece of fruit, whether it's an apple or an orange or whatever your fruit, your banana, whatever. And most of the time it can look good on the outside, and there can be things on the inside that cause you to spit it out. You ever bitten into an apple? It looked good. You washed it up. It was crisp. It seemed crisp. It was nice and red or golden, whatever type of apple you like. And you bite into it, and it's mushy, and it's all bruised inside. Couldn't tell it from the outside, but it's all bruised. You know, that's the way a lot of believers' fruit is. Because of life experiences and things that have happened to us, what we produce as a believer is bruised and not really edible or pleasing. The Bible tells us that we are to produce fruit. That's not an option. As a believer, I am to produce fruit from my life. And that fruit is to bear a resemblance of the fruit of Christ, if you want to look at it. So we're going to look at some things, maybe from a little different perspective this morning than you've heard. I don't know, maybe you've heard this before, but Galatians 5, 16 says, I say then, walk in the Spirit. Turn to your neighbor and say, walk in the Spirit. Walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusts against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary to one another, so that you do not do the things that you wish. Now right here, Paul is writing about a struggle that we have as human beings, as believers, wanting to walk one way, needing to walk another. And the question is, who's going to win that battle in your life? What's going to bear in your life? Okay? So he tells us, you know, you're not doing the things that you want to or that you wish. Verse 18, but if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now it's imperative and important that you and I recognize that if I'm walking and living in the Spirit, I am not under the law. Now the works of the flesh, and hear me, these works of the flesh are subject to the law. We're going to talk about it. Works of the flesh are evident, which are adultery, fornication, uncleanness. You know, most Christians understand and don't really deal, I'm not going to say they don't deal with it, but you know, it's not really something, we don't argue about that. Lewdness, idolatry, sorcery, we those things we recognize. And we get into some that kind of creep into the life of a believer. Hatred. Yes, believe it or not, I've met a lot of Christians who had some hatred in their life. And can I tell you that hatred is birthed from unforgiveness? Okay? So he says hatred, contentions, this is stuff we deal with. Jealousies, ooh, come on, can I get a witness? Outbursts of wrath. You ever lose your temper? Selfish ambitions. dissensions, and it goes into heresy, envy, murders, drunkenness, revelries, and the like, of which I tell you beforehand, just as I told you in time past, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Now, it's important that we recognize that if those things are bearing in our life, then we're in danger. We're not going to inherit the kingdom of God. It's what Paul's telling us right here. That's what he's telling us. Okay? Now, what I want you to say is, I'm not saying that you have please hear me and understand. I'm not saying that if it arises in a moment in your life and it's not your normal or it's not a common thing, that's not going to immediately send you to hell. I don't believe that, because we could lose our temper and I'm not immediately going to hell. But if that is the fruit that I'm bearing on a consistent basis, then there's an issue in my life that I need to change or I need to fix. Verse 22, he says, but the fruit of the Spirit, everybody say the fruit of the Spirit. Fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law, and those who are Christ's have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Let us not be conceited, provoking one another, envying one another. Would you bow your heads as we go to the Lord in prayer? Father, we love you and we praise you. We thank you, Father, for your goodness and mercy. We ask in the name of Jesus Christ, Lord, that you just perform your word in us. God, help us to hear and receive what you are speaking to us today. Help us to receive the seed of your word, that it might be implanted in our heart, in our spirit, and produce fruit that would be glorifying and honoring to you. I pray that I would only say the things that you would have me to say. And God, the ears of the hearers would hear and receive what you are speaking to them as individuals and as to us as a congregation. We give you glory and honor and praise in Jesus' name. And the church said,
Amen.
So the title of this message is, what about your fruit? But the first point or first question is, what are you producing? What are you producing? You know, in here, for the history of the last 8 years I've been here, many of you know that I worked in a bakery for 7 years in our early marriage and in our early life. And one of the things that we did was we produced. You know, I went in, at the beginning of my shift, and one of my jobs was a mixer, and I mixed the dough. And that was just the first thing on the line. I put the flour and the water and all the ingredients and put it all in there and ran it for the time that it was supposed to run, and then kicked it out into a huge trowel, whatever, and they rolled it to this other area, and then they, with machines, they cut it into loaf sizes, and they rolled it up, and they did what was necessary. But that wasn't the finished product. Then they ran it through the oven. And once it went through the oven, and it went down this cooling belt, and all up in the ceiling of the deal cooling off, and then it would go to the wrapping, which was at the other end of the plant, which was about a football field and a half away from where I had mixed it all up 6 hours earlier. And then they put it on racks, and then later in my job there, one of the places I worked was not the beginning, but the end, was distribution, which they would throw it into this huge freezer, and they would blast freeze it to preserve the freshness, is what they said. And then we'd pull it out of this blast freezer and put it in the holding freezer, and then we would get orders, and we would load these 18-wheeler semis full of these racks that were about 9 to 10 feet tall on wheels, metal racks, and they were full of bread, trays of bread, and we'd load them up. We'd get 3 across, and I forget how many back. And it was what we were producing. Was we produced sandwich bread, we produced variety bread, we produced crescent rolls, we produced all kinds of hearth breads, little Kaiser rolls and different things like that. We even produced donuts and rolls and cakes and all this stuff. You know, we weren't Hostess, we were the knockoff. Yeah. We weren't Little Debbie's. We weren't as good as either one of those, but we sold a lot of product because we produced a lot of product. And we shipped it from Paris, Texas. We would ship it up north all the way up to, I forget the farthest north. I think it was up into Nebraska. We shipped it to California. We shipped it to the East Coast, to Maryland. We shipped in all kinds of parts of between. We shipped. It's what we were producing. And we had two guys that worked in what we call quality control. Now, I don't know why you would only hire two quality control officers for a plant that produced as much as we produced, because we had a bread side and a cake side. But they were all over the plant. They would come, because I would mix the dough, and then I would go watch what I had mixed earlier that day come out of the oven, and one of the things that I mixed up were crescent rolls. Anybody remember those BK crescent roll breakfast croissants? I probably mixed them if you ate them in the 80s and 90s. Or 70s, no, when did I start? 80s, early 80s. I probably mixed those if you had something that was my product, especially in Texas, even if it was bad. But they would come out of that oven hot off the line, and man, we were allowed to eat some of them. We'd throw a little butter on them, take them to the break room and eat. But these quality control guys, they would come by and they would pick a pan, the whole pan, whole tray, and they'd take it to their office. And they would cut it up, and they would dissect it, and they would run tests, and they would look for the quality of what was being produced. Now, I'm telling you that to tell you this, that we need to inspect our own, what we're producing in our life. If you're not inspecting what you're producing with your life, then you might be in trouble. Now, I want to tell you, when I was working in that plant, they were very careful and meticulous about keeping things clean and not putting out a bad product. And I know that they had even metal detectors where the cakes would go through. And if they got the smallest shavings, if it accidentally got in there because you had to work on the machines or they might break, and they were metal, and it could happen. It actually did happen, not on my line, but on a different line where they had some metal, and they kicked out the whole day's work. They threw it all away. They didn't reuse it. They didn't give it to the poor. They said, we can't have anybody partaking of something that is not quality. And too many believers and too many Christians want others to try to partake of something that's not quality. So what are we producing? The enemy wants us to produce contrary to what God says. It's the enemy's desire to cause you and I to produce fruit that is deficient and not what the Bible tells us we should be producing. Now I want you to turn to Genesis chapter 3, because I want you to see something here. We're not going to spend a lot of time there, but I want you to see this. Because in Genesis chapter 3 we see the fall, what we call the fall of man. And it's a very, very interesting passage of Scripture. I'm sure you've read it before. But the Bible says in verse 1 of chapter 3 in Genesis, "Now the serpent was more cunning than any beast in the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman," now listen, because the enemy is constantly speaking into your ear and mine. "He said to the woman, 'Has God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden?' And the woman said to the serpent, 'We may eat the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst or the middle of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat it, nor shall you touch it, lest you die.'" Verse 4, "Then the serpent said to the woman, 'You will not surely die, for God knows that in the day that you eat it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil.' So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was pleasant to be to the eyes, and a desirable tree to make one wise, she took of the fruit and ate it." And I want to stop right there. I really want to contrast this to Matthew chapter 4. Because, you know, the Bible tells us that Genesis shows us the first Adam. Romans 5 tells us there was a second Adam. We know that it was Jesus Christ. And in this place in Genesis where, and by the way, it deals with fruit. And I'm not talking about what they ate. It's what they produced with their life. Now hear me and understand. Because a little bit farther in this verse, in Genesis a little bit farther down, when their eyes were opened, they had eaten of the fruit, and their eyes were opened, and they realized that they were naked, and they became ashamed of who they were or what was going on. They took fig leaves, sewed them together, and when the Bible says that when they heard, in the New King James, it says the sound of God. okay, of the Lord God. In the King James, it says this, the voice of the Lord God. Now, that phrase is very interesting to me, because when it speaks of the voice, understand, they didn't have the written word, but they didn't need the written word, because they were walking with God and He was directly speaking to them His word. So they had the word of God. He had told them, don't eat of the tree. Don't eat of the fruit. Don't let that be something. But if you look at Matthew chapter 5 or 4, when the Bible tells us that after the baptism of Jesus, the Spirit led Him into the wilderness. It's interesting to me, and I don't know, maybe you've seen this already, but as I was really focusing on this, it's interesting to me how that the garden experience for the first Adam turned into a wilderness experience. And how the wilderness of the second experience of the second Adam turned into the garden experience. But the difference is this, the temptation was the same. Because if you look at what the serpent said, and the Bible says, it was pleasing to her eyes, it was good to eat, and desirous. Three things that we see Jesus facing in the wilderness was the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. We read the fruit of that in Galatians chapter 5. When we succumb to the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life, what is going to be produced in our life are the works of the flesh found in Galatians chapter 5. Starts off with adultery and fornication, and we don't want to talk about those because we don't do that in church, but we do some of the other stuff, and there are some people that do that stuff. So we need to deal with it as believers. What am I producing? What's being produced out of my life? Now I'm going to tell you something, because I read a deal, Dennis Tanner, he was a missionary who came. I read something he put online today. I think he put it on today or yesterday, but I read it today. This morning when I was eating my breakfast, I was reading what he said, and he said there's this push to where in the church that we should just, our testimony of Jesus Christ should be enough in us that we don't have to say anything. And he said, will people come to the cross if there's nothing said? And it was very provoking for me, because I do believe we ought to live Jesus in our life, but we also ought to talk Jesus. And they ought to line up and match up. The Jesus that is in me ought to line up with the Jesus that comes out of my mouth. Just because you're living Him doesn't mean you shouldn't talk about Him. And just because you're talking about Him doesn't mean you shouldn't live Him. They go hand in hand. So what are you producing? The Bible tells us in Genesis that she saw that it was good. She desired it. She listened to the voice. And can I tell you? I think she was off in using the word of God to try to fight the serpent. Because nowhere do we read, I'm not saying it didn't happen, but nowhere do we read that God said, in the day that we touch it, we'll die. That's not what He said. He said, if you eat it, you'll die. But read what she said to the serpent. When she was, understand, and you got to hear this. Understand that she was in a battle in this moment in the garden. She was in a position of decision in the garden that was going to show fruit one way or the other. This is what she said. She said this. We may eat of the trees of the garden, but the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat it, nor shall you touch it, lest you die. Now, when God was telling Adam, I don't want you to eat that one, it doesn't say that He said, don't touch it. Now, maybe He did, but it doesn't say that. Why are you being so particular? Because you need to be particular about how you fight the enemy. And you don't need to trust quotes from good people, catchy phrases, or even songs. You want to fight the enemy and you want to be successful at it, you need to use the word and the word alone. Matthew chapter 4, The Bible says Satan came to Jesus and tempted him three times. And three times the Word made flesh, the living Word. He did not argue. He did not debate. He simply said, "It is written. Thou shalt not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God." That was the first one. You see, we as believers, we're talking about fruit. I understand what we're talking about, being empowered by the Spirit. I want to bear fruit. But if I'm going to bear fruit, I've got to know how to bear fruit. We talked a little bit last week about being connected to the vine. I can't produce anything without being connected. We talked about relationship. I preached it on Wednesday night as well. If we're not connected to Jesus, if we don't have that relationship, we're not going to produce what we should be producing. I don't care how hard you try. If you're not connected to Jesus, you of yourself, me of myself, cannot produce good fruit. You can produce good works, but not good fruit. Wow, that's, what do you mean by that? Hey, there's all kinds of people, different religions that do good works. Don't believe in God, don't believe in Jesus Christ, and do good works. You can produce good works. That's not that works as a Christian are supposed to be an outproduct of our relationship with Jesus, but they are not the fruit. Nowhere can I find in Scripture that works equal fruit. We have a list of the fruit. There's some other lists that are shorter, but this is the main one we go to in Galatians chapter 5. The fruit of the Spirit is what? Love. First one listed. Anybody? Okay, love. There's nine of them. My grandkids can say them. I'm not trying to shame you. I'm confessing that I'm not sure I could say them all right now, all nine by memory. But you understand, I don't have to say all nine of them. And now you may disagree with this, but I'm going to tell you. In the kingdom of God, in serving Him, if you can get the first one, the second one will come. Because out of love flows joy. We're going to talk about that not today. But that's just a setup for next Sunday. Okay? If you and I are called to produce something, we have to be connected. It also has to be within us. Empowered by the Spirit. Jesus told His disciples, He said this, "If you abide in Me, and My words abide in you." If you abide in Me, and My words abide in you, okay, I want to build right here. Just give me a second. I got 30 minutes left. So I want to build something right here. Another place Jesus gives them a parable. He said, "Whoever hears My words and does them, it's like a man who builds his house on a rock. And when the storm, the wind and the waves, when they come, it'll stand. But to the one who hears My words and doesn't do them, it's like a man who's building his house on the sand. And when the wind comes and the waves come, the storm comes, the sand's going to start to shift and that house is going to fall. It's going to collapse. The ruin's going to be great. It's not going to withstand the tempest. It's not going to withstand what the enemy throws at it and what life brings." Again, He says, "Whoever hears what I say." We're talking about the Word of God. We see in Genesis where God came down. That word, when I told you that phrase in Genesis 3, when it says, "And the Lord God," they heard the sound of the voice of the Lord God. That word, Lord God, Lord is Jehovah or Yehovah in the Hebrew. And God is, you know, there's a couple of different names for God. The one used in Genesis 1 and Genesis 3 are the same, Elohim. I'm telling you that for a reason. Because what I see and picture in my mind, when God came down, it wasn't just the Father. And it wasn't just the pre-incarnate Jesus Christ. It was also the Spirit. Because that word Elohim is a plural form of God's name. Like in Genesis, when he said, let us make man in our image and in our likeness. You understand the words? Let us make man in our image. Not, I'm going to make man. Who was he talking to? It was the three of them in unity having the conversation. And the three of them would come down in the cool of the day and walk with Adam. Can you imagine that? God the Father, God the Son, the Trinity, walking in the garden, communing with Adam. Hey, Adam, how was your day? Oh, man, my day was awesome. I woke up. It was dew on the ground. The sun came up. I mean, think about this. Garden experience. No thorns, no thistles, no goat heads. That's a bonus right there, because I'm pretty sure he didn't have shoes in that moment. Maybe your Adam did. Mine was barefooted. Okay. Most importantly, no mosquitoes, no chiggers. Speaking from experience, no ticks. Because you walk through the garden in East Texas, you're probably going to pick some up. I mean, he's living the life. He's not having to work. He tends the garden, but that's not work. That's a hobby. His two responsibilities were to walk with God and tend the garden. That was it. What a life! But he chose to bear fruit that didn't honor God. And his garden experience turned into a wilderness experience. Because the curse was this. You're going to toil and sweat. You're going to fight stickers and brambles. You're going to fight. You're going to have to toil in the dirt from where you came. And when you die, and oh, by the way, I didn't create him to die. But now you're going to die, because I told you, if you eat the fruit, that's when you're going to die. But the death was more than just a physical death, because it took Adam a while to die. I mean, he lived 900-something years. It was a spiritual death in that there was no relationship with God like he had before. And then humanity is caught in a wilderness experience. And it's all about the fruit. It's all about the fruit, because Adam and Eve chose to bear fruit that was in opposition to what God said. We, you and I, have no excuse to not know what is expected of us. We have no excuse. We should know what's expected of us. I shared this a month or so ago, I just started this job in November working with MISD. And today, I still don't know exactly what's expected of me. I'm not saying that to be funny. That's the honest truth, because anywhere I've ever went to work outside of ministry, there was always a job description. I like a job description because I know if I cover that and they get upset with me, I can turn that around and say, I did this. You know, in ministry, we're a little different. Here's our job description. My second paying job, not with your dad, but the next one that I had as a youth pastor, I was in Louisiana as a youth pastor at a large church. And I went in, and the pastor that hired me, I've been there 2 months, and he said, I'm leaving. I said, excuse me? He said, I'm leaving. I'm resigning this Sunday. I'm like, wow. He said, And I had been asking him for a job description. And he said, write your own job description and I'll sign it. I've been there 2 months. So I did a page. I typed it up. Man, I had it. It was professional. I wasn't trying to get out of doing anything. I put everything that I thought I was supposed to be doing in that job description. And I took it to his office. And I put it on his desk. And he was sitting there and he read through it. And he said, this is very good. You left one thing out. I said, oh, I'm sorry. I can retype it. He said, no, I'll write it in. I'll sign it. He was already packing up his office. The last line on my job description. And anything else the senior pastor deems necessary for you to do. And he signed it. He said, now show that to the next guy that comes in. I'm like, yeah, thanks a lot. That helped me out a bunch. Because that next guy that came in liked to work me to death. You see, we have a job description as believers. You have a job description. Jesus gave us a job description when he said, go into all the world and preach the gospel. Making disciples, baptizing them in my name, casting out devils, healing the sick. All the stuff we're supposed to be doing, that's our job description. As we go about fulfilling that job description, it matters what we're producing in our life in the way of fruit. I'm just going to tell you, if I'm a Christian, I'm trying not to get into next week. If I'm a Christian and they don't see love in my life, now I'm going to tell you something. There's a difference in love and acceptance. Now, I'll qualify that. I can love somebody and not agree with their lifestyle. I can love somebody and disagree with a decision they make. That's where you get into joy, because it's a little harder to have joy when you're at odds with somebody. And let's face it, this Christian life is not just about, hear me, not just about me and God. It's about me and God and how I show other people my relationship with him and what I tell them and how I tell them. Because again, I'm supposed to be producing fruit. The fruit glorifies God, but the fruit's not for God. The fruit is for other people to take off of my life. You know, I'm just going to sit here because my legs are tired. I'm going to have to give Gina a raise, because that singing and playing at the same time takes it out of you. That was the first time, I ain't looking for a pat on the back or brownie points, I'm just saying, that was the first time I have led and played without a piano, another lead instrument. I looked at Speedy this morning and said, you have to carry me, brother. He did too. I appreciate it. Thank you. It ain't easy what's expected of us. And so if we're going to produce fruit and it's going to glorify God, here's what it's going to do. If I'm producing fruit as a Christian and Al needs something in his life, maybe he's hit a rough patch. Maybe he's hit a difficult moment and he's having trouble with joy. Where's he going to get that joy? The Bible tells us that you who are stronger help the weaker. And I'm not saying that because I think Brother Al's weak. He's a very intimidating figure. But I'm saying that because we all go through moments of weakness and being down. And our love is challenged, and our joy is non-existent, and it's hard to be kind. It's hard to be long-suffering. It's hard to be some of those to produce some of those fruits in our life. And so we need fellow believers to come along that are producing that so we can partake of that and get back on the right track. Amen. Here's the thing. I've said this a couple of weeks ago. You can't give what you don't have. And if you're not spending time in the Word and spending time with Him, you're not going to have what you need or anything that anybody else can participate with or partake of. What you're going to begin to produce, what I'm going to begin to produce in my life is not going to be from that good list, but it's going to be from that bad list. Because He told us in the first of Galatians, the Spirit and the flesh fight against one another. And if you walk in the Spirit, you're not subject to the law. But if you walk in the flesh, you are. We like verses like, there is therefore now no condemnation to those who live in Christ Jesus and walk after the Spirit. But what we don't realize is if I'm not walking in the Spirit and not living in Christ, then I am bound by the law, not of life in Christ Jesus, but the law that brings death. Why am I bound by that? Because I am participating in the works or the fruit of that law. Now, I'm not judged if I'm walking in the Spirit and I'm producing according to the a life in the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus. That law set me free from the law of sin and death. But that is a different law. And when I am living and walking within the law of life in Christ Jesus, then it's because I am producing fruit of the Spirit. Now turn to your neighbor and say, you can't do this alone. You can't do this alone. We have to be empowered by the Spirit. We have to be empowered by the Holy Spirit. And I'm not putting down tongues. I'm just saying there's more to Him than speaking in tongues. There is so much more that He brings to the table. Well, he gave me a couple of lessons this week. I'm not going to share them with you, but He gave me a couple of lessons and He really got my attention. I mean, just, it wasn't, you know, sometimes the Holy Spirit speaks softly to you. Yeah, and sometimes it's like, I got that this week. Twice. About the same thing. And I thought I heard it the first time, but evidently it wasn't enough. I didn't respond exactly the way I should have, apparently, because I got it again. It was about Tuesday or Wednesday. Boom! The Holy Ghost said, here. I said, okay, I got it. Yeah, I got it. I understand. I'm good. I'm all good. Yesterday, same exact thing. Bam! Wait. Now what? You told me this here, and you're speaking this again. Evidently, I'm not hearing it. Because the problem's not with Him. Evidently, I'm not getting this the way that He wants me to get it. So I stopped. I just stopped everything I was doing. I was like, okay, enlighten me. And He began to. I'm like, okay, I understand now. Please don't do this again. I understand. I learned. I'm lesson learned. I'm not going to go down that road. I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to. I get it. I understand. Please don't let this happen again. But it was a result of fruit that was in my life. I thought it was quality fruit. Apparently not. You know, Paul told us, he said, don't think more highly of yourself than you ought to. You know, when you think you're really producing what God wants, and then it's not. It kind of lends to you backing up and saying, okay, I've been going about this the wrong way. Maybe it was pride. Maybe it was a lack of humility. Maybe it was just not really understanding and knowing what the Word said about that situation. Because here's the thing. Adam and Eve had the Word in the garden, and they failed. They were in closer relationship in the literal sense with God than you and I ever. And they failed. Direct access. And they failed. Jesus comes along, second Adam. He starts his ministry with a wilderness experience. Because that's where humanity is, in the wilderness. Lost, separated, hurting, hungry, alone. And the enemy comes and thinks, I got him now. I had the first Adam. I can get the second one. But he failed to take into account that the second Adam was the Word made flesh. They both had the Word. Adam walked with God cool of the day. He heard the Word, the voice of the Lord God. But the second Adam, it was resident. It was part of his DNA, his makeup. The Word just, he opened his mouth and the Word came out because he was the Word made flesh. It is written, it is written, it is written. The last time he said, get out of here. Get out of here, away, leave. You shall worship the Lord God, and him only shall you serve. Get out of here. I'm done with you. I'm not going to mess with you anymore. He was able to do that because of the Word. Now, I want to bring this home right here. I was about to call Brother Ken to the piano when he's not here. So I'm going to ask them to start something very softly and hopefully no commercials. If you're not putting the Word in, you're probably not going to produce the right fruit. If you're not in relationship and connected with Him, Jesus, you're not going to produce the right fruit. It seems on the surface, seems like it's really not fair. God's asking a whole lot of us, right? He's asking me to love people who hate me. That's asking a whole lot, isn't it? He's asking me to speak blessing when people curse, or pray for them when they use me. He's asking me to do things, Chip, that in my own self, it ain't happening. No matter how good of a person I am, it's not going to take place in and of myself. I can be a nice person and not have Jesus. I can have moments of niceness. But if I am going to produce the fruit that God is calling me to, and if you're going to produce the fruit that God has called to produce, you and I must be empowered by the Holy Spirit. And what that means is this. I yield myself as His vessel. Paul wrote it this way. He said, I'm not my own. I've been bought with the price. I've been bought with the blood of Jesus Christ, and I'm not my own. I don't own myself anymore. I belong to Him. And because I belong to Him, He has filled me with His Spirit and His power to do the things that I can't do in and of myself. I believe that covers every area of your life. I believe it covers your job life, your family life, your financial life, your spiritual life, your emotional life. You name it, across the spectrum. I believe that being empowered by the Spirit to produce fruit that glorifies and honors the King, and is something that others can take and receive from, that you give because you have to give. Jesus said, freely you have received, freely give. We, you and I, ought to be trees of life. I love one of the descriptions in Revelation where it talks about these trees that are along the water that flows from the throne. And it's interesting because I believe it says that the nations will eat of their, or will be healed by their leaves. And they'll eat of their fruit. Now, I take that as in heaven and the new earth and all. I take that as literal, but I also see it as a spiritual thing that I ought to be, if I'm producing fruit, if my life is producing Jesus, that other people ought to be able to partake of the things of my life, the leaves and the fruit. Because, you know, it doesn't hurt a tree to shed its fruit or for someone to pick that fruit. It doesn't hurt the tree. The tree is still able to produce the fruit. In fact, when a tree or bush is that produces fruit is pruned a little bit, it'll produce more. We get that. Jesus tells us about that in the vine. So if I'm a believer and I'm connected to Him and I'm producing fruit, empowered by the Spirit to do and be kingdom life, other people are going to come along and see and partake of my life and be impacted by it in a way that's going to change their life. I don't always know how, because I'm just the tree. And the fruit isn't really mine. It's produced by what's inside of me. And what's inside of me is the Spirit of God. If I'm walking in the Spirit, living in the Spirit, producing what the Spirit wants produced in my life. I'm going to ask you to stand. I'm going to ask you just to bow your head right where you're standing. And I want to ask this question. First and foremost, if you're in this place and you're not in right relationship with Jesus, if you are not living for Him, if you're not saved by the blood of Jesus Christ, maybe you're away from Him. You've known Him, have been in relationship, and you need to come back to your first love. Maybe you've never known Him. I don't know, but I just feel constrained to give you an opportunity. Either to accept Jesus or to renew your first word. If you're in this place and you need to set things right with Him, I'm going to ask you to do something. I'm going to ask you to step out of your seat and walk to the front, and we're going to pray with you. I'm going to ask the elders to come and just stand up here facing the congregation. And if you'd say, Pastor, preacher, my life hasn't been what it should be, and I want to get it back in order. The Bible says if we believe in our heart and confess with our mouth on the Lord Jesus Christ, that we'll be saved. It also tells us that if we confess our sins, He's able to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. I'm not asking you to confess your sins to anybody but Him, because He's the only one that can save you. But if you're in this place and you need to make things right, I want to give you that first opportunity right now. In the name of Jesus Christ. I feel like there's two or three the Holy Spirit is laying on my heart. I don't know who, but I believe there's two or three. But you've been sitting in here just wishing it would all hurry up and end. You've been uncomfortable. That's the Holy Spirit convicting you. He's been speaking to you. You have not been walking life in the Spirit, but according to the flesh. I'm going to ask you to come right now in the name of Jesus. Just step out of where you're standing and walk to this front, and someone down here will pray for you. Would you come? We'll pray together. Father, we love you. We praise you, God. We thank you. Lord, we worship you. Would you just lift your hands to him right now? Just lift your hands to him right now. Lord Jesus, bless your name. We praise your name, God. Lord. Come against a root of bitterness. In the name of Jesus Christ. Come against a root of bitterness in the name of Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name. Don't hang on to that. Don't hang on to it. You need to let it go. We want to pray with you. Next thing I want to do is I want to say, if you would say, Lord, I want to walk according to your Spirit this week, day by day, moment by moment, empowered by you to produce fruit in my life, I want you just to, if you can, step out into the aisle and just lift your hands. I'm not asking you to come to the front, but step out in the aisle and say, Lord, I want to walk empowered by your Spirit to produce fruit in my life that will touch others. Do it right now. Just step out into the aisle and say, Lord, I want to walk according to your Spirit. Empowered by your Spirit to produce fruit in my life in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, help me bear much fruit that would bring glory and honor to you. Help me, Lord, to produce fruit that would glorify you through my life and with my life. Let my words and my actions bring glory to your kingdom. In the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, if you'd lay your hand on someone close beside you or in front of you or behind you, just lay your hand on their shoulder and just pray for them right now. Lord, in the name of Jesus Christ, we pray one for another. Lord, I pray for my brother right now in Jesus' name, God, that you would touch him. Lord, I pray for this congregation, Father, that you would minister. Lord God, you know what we need even before we ask. Lord, in the name of Jesus Christ, Lord, I speak life over my brother. God, I pray for fruitfulness in his life, God. Lord, Holy Spirit, produce in his life and through his life in the name of Jesus Christ. We give you glory and honor and praise in his precious holy name. Amen. Amen. Well, just give the Lord a praise right now in your own way. Give the Lord a praise. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Thank you so much for being here. God bless you. Go with God and have a great week.